signing agreements. The text, the context was completely different to what it was today. The biggest champions of free trade were the United States and Europe. Today, the United States is the biggest opponent of free trade. You saw countries who would oppose bilateral trade agreements between countries. Now everybody is talking of bilateral trade agreements. We used to be told, don't have any bilateral trade agreement, because this is a contradiction to the global trading pattern. It's changing. Countries are now looking at bilateral trade, looking at bilateral trading agreements. And this is where, again, leadership has to recognize the global changing patterns, because it's not necessary that you have to be an exporter. It's not necessary that your products are exported. It's not necessary that services are exported. But that will form the architecture of the economy in the future. And this architecture of the economy is what is going to determine how your business, how leaders will be able to steer and drive and shape their own corporate structure. And this, I think, is one of the most important things to recognize, that how the world is changing. Looking at trade, we are seeing trade wars. We are seeing China under pressure. We are also seeing an Indian economy which is under pressure. We all know the Indian economy is under pressure. And unless we are able to recognize, unless we are able to accept, there is a feeling that nothing is wrong. That's the biggest mistake we can make. In the four-wheeler and two-wheeler industry, I've always said this, and I've said this in many speeches, that the index of growth is the two-wheeler industry. That is what determines the economic activity of the country. And what you see on your screen of per capita income, that you see on your screen, what don't you see on your screen? What you do not see in your screen is the disposable per capita income. 8,000 rupee or 10,000 rupee job in Mumbai or Pune or Bangalore or Delhi means nothing. You can't survive on it. But an 8 or 10,000 rupee job in other parts of the country, in my own district, means one SUV. Because it's a disposable income. He is going to get a loan. And it is this disposable income which drives the Indian economy. So, how do we generate economic activity? By saying the construction sector needs to be stimulated. Can we do it? By saying this sector, let's reduce the GST on autos. Will that happen? Reducing it by 2-3%, you all know it won't happen. By 2-4%, there's somebody who gets a 2,000 rupees buying a 6-8 lakh rupee vehicle, if he stays 10-15,000 more or less, less commitment. But again, it is the sentiment. And we all know how the sentiment has got affected. Sentiment drives investment. Sentiment drives investment. There are such great investment opportunities in Africa, in South America, in Central America. But there's no investment sentiment. So unless the sentiment is also right, everything else will be perfect. Everything will be perfect. Business model will be perfect. But investment sentiment is not there. It's not going to happen. So this is what the leadership needs to understand. In global trade, we are seeing a changing Europe. We are seeing a more nationalistic Europe. We are seeing a more nationalistic United States. We are seeing aging economy, aging population, whether Japan or Germany, how they've over the years shifted their manufacturing operations. This is what you want to smell. This is what you want to foresee. And that is what will define leadership. Having said that, I must say that agriculture is a very important thing in India. And although sitting in CII, people don't recognize the importance of agriculture. In Madhya Pradesh, 70% of the population of Madhya Pradesh is dependent upon agriculture. In a village, a kirana shop, a provision shop, his shop is dependent on the income of the farmer, on the purchasing power of the farmer. If the farmer doesn't have purchasing power, it doesn't happen. His shop is not going to run. The person who repairs tractors. So 70% of the people are dependent upon agriculture. How do we, and the national figure would be about 50%. We many times quietly put this 50% aside. But unless they drive what I was saying, the disposable income, it is the agricultural sector which drives the disposable income. And if the agricultural sector is going to be under distress, the whole economy will be under distress. What we are seeing today is just not happening because of the last 6 months or 8 months. This is on the island. For the last 2 years, then we are seeing farmer suicide. We are seeing big growth. We are trumpeting growth in agricultural production. What does that mean? Agricultural production has gone up. The problem 20 years ago was a problem of shortages. Today, it's a problem of excess in agriculture. How do we deal with the excess? The challenge is different. If there is a shortage, you can import. But what happens when you have excess? That is what it is. And I did a calculation when I was Commerce Minister. I did a calculation in the context of the world and in India that how many people in India eat one meal a day? Tell me, how many people in India eat one meal a day? What happens if they start eating two meals a day? What will it do to food? What will it do to transportation? What will it do to logistics? What happens when those number of people who have a mere two meals? What happens when you start having a better two meals per day? What will it do to our economy? And it was startling. It was mind-boggling. Whatever do to agriculture. We did this, I did this in the context of global trade negotiations. And what would happen if everybody in the developing countries, whether it's South America, Central America, whether it's Asia, starts having two meals a day? What will be the food requirement? What will be the logistics? What will we need? How will this food be cooked? All these challenges are the challenges which we are going to face. And in agriculture, we have to, the challenge today is a challenge of excess, not a challenge of shortage. How does a farmer get a right price? Right price means inflation. When we were in government, there was a constant quarrel in the cabinet whether we should increase the minimum support price. Constant quarrel. And I suggest you go and see on the internet today. What was the MSP, the minimum support price for agriculture, between 2004 and 2014, and from 2014 till today? We every year would increase the minimum support price to keep stimulating the rural economy. We brought in the Rural Employment Guarantee Scheme. What? To stimulate purchasing power. Because somebody who is just doing nothing and now he gets some work on the employment guarantee scheme, it's a disposable income. He'll go and buy a new sari. He'll buy a new cycle. So these were decisions. But what did it lead to? It led to inflation. The inflation between 2010 and 2014 was very high. But every developing country across the world, history says that, has to have inflation. So if you target zero inflation, what's going to be the consequences of zero inflation? So the MSP, from 2014 was an increase. MSP was increased. The rural sector went down 50% of the population. In Madhya Pradesh, 70% of the population was impacted. What happened? It hits consumer products, it hits white goods, it hits industry, it hits everything. So, we got to recognize this. There are certain basics which I think sometimes, I have no hesitation in saying, CII becomes oblivious. CII sometimes is in its own orbit. There is just not one orbit in our country. There are many, many orbits. And we are seeing today tremendous urbanization take place.